I would like to turn to our next speaker, Francis Godwin, which is the Office Director of the Office of Manufacturing Quality at the United States FDA. And he's going to give us more details in terms of alcohol requirements for hand sanitizer production. Francis, you have the mic and the floor, sir. Good morning.
All right. Thank you, everyone. So we'll start with the stock disclaimer that, you know, the views are mine and not entirely necessarily the FDA's. Next slide, please. So before I begin, I do want to point out that, you know, all the slides that we're presenting today will be shared with everyone. What I typically do in my presentations is I will put extra slides in for context so you can take them back later and look at them. So you may see me skipping over some slides relatively quickly. I figure giving more information is better than less. So today I'm going to talk about what the Office of Manufacturing Quality does, OMQ. We'll talk about hand sanitizer. And then we're going to get into the requirements for making alcohol for hand sanitizer during the pandemic. I'm going to talk specifically about some impurities. We're going to talk about the safety concerns that Dr. Michelle talked about. And then I'm going to go into some cases that we've actually seen with substitution to kind of show you what we've been seeing out there. And then I'm going to talk at the end about the methanol testing requirements for drug product manufacturers, which has been mentioned a few times already. So next slide, please. So OMQ, the Office of Manufacturing Quality, what do we do? Next slide. So we are in the Center for Drug Evaluation and Research, which is one of the arms of FDA, and we are specifically in the Office of Compliance. In the Office of Compliance, our mission statement is that we are here to shield patients from poor quality, unsafe, or ineffective drugs through compliance strategies and risk-based enforcement actions. Next slide, please. So OMQ, we are the Manufacturing Compliance Office. So we primarily deal with compliance with current good manufacturing practice, also known as CGMP for drugs. And most of our actions are based on FDA inspection reports and evidence gathered by FDA investigators. And we take reg actions and implement policy to protect the public from adulterated drugs. And adulterated seems like this old term, and it is. And I'll explain what that means on the next slide, please. So adulterated drugs, and that's my dog that you're hearing, adulterated drugs come from the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act. It started in 1938, so some of the language is a little bit dated, but it's still there and still works today. And it talks about if a drug is made under unsanitary conditions, think Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, which is the impetus for that, failure to conform with current good manufacturing practice. Then we get into some of the other ones. 501B, strength, quality, or purity differing from an official compendium. And this is where the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act actually specifies the United States Pharmacopeia as an official compendia recognized by U.S. law. We also have 501C, which talks about if something is misrepresentative strength, if it's subpotent, if it's not in a compendium. There are certain drugs that are not in a compendium, and that's where 501C comes into play. We get into 501D, which is substitution, which I'll talk more about later. And then 501J is a drug is deemed adulterated if the manufacturer or owner delays, refuses, or limits an FDA inspection. Next slide, please. So CGMP is primarily what we deal with. The enforcement discretion guidances talk about when we will and won't enforce it, but just to point out that, you know, 501A2B, which is the good manufacturing practice statute, talks about, you know, the methods used and controls for manufacturing, processing, packing, or holding a drug do not conform with current good manufacturing practices, then they are adulterated. Next slide, please. To kind of get away from the legal ease, GMP is really the requirements that help ensure drugs meet their quality specifications, including purity, are safe to use, and have the ingredients and strength that they claim to have on their labels. Next slide, please. So we are in the compliance office, so we do take a lot of regulatory actions. Excuse me. This is kind of, we call it the wheel. It kind of details out the various actions that we can take and what we did in 2020. So if you look at the wheel, you know, we've issued 92 regulatory discretions. These are instances where we'll work with drug shortages and also with manufacturers to supply drugs. And we've had to do quite a bit of that during COVID as the manufacturing base has ramped up pharmaceutical supply for COVID patients. At the same time, we'll issue warning letters, which are advisory actions to firms when we find problems with drugs and how they're made. We may meet with firms. That's what regulatory meetings are. And then import alerts, which is something we're going to talk a little bit more about. An import alert is a mechanism where drugs from a facility may be not allowed into the United States. And we had 100 of those last year, which is quite a lot. Next slide, please. So when we're talking about import alerts, you know, we have issued import alerts for drug manufacturers all over the world, and that's because the drugs for the United States come from all over the world. You'll notice these different numbers and colors. Basically, you know, what we're talking about are the various adulteration provisions of why a firm's been put on import alert. 9932, that is if a firm refuses an FDA inspection, we'll put them on import alert and say, no, your drugs cannot come here. The green ones, these are if there's an actual FDA inspection or a records request of a firm, and we find that there's violations from CGMP that warrant putting on import alert. And then you'll notice this kind of teal bluish thing, 6678. This is a new import alert that was implemented just in 2020, and it's become the lion's share. And this is import alerts based on sample results, where drugs cross the border, we coordinate with Customs and Border Patrol, we will sample the material, and if we find that it's violative, we can place an entire facility on import alert. And you'll notice that you'll see Mexico is the lion's share of these, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that later. Next slide, please. These are the warning letters that we've been issuing, and I'm just going to gloss over really quickly. It talks about the impetus for various warning letters. The only thing I want to highlight is that the majority of our warning letters are over in the over-the-counter drug space. That's not a surprise considering the majority of drug manufacturers make OTC drugs. But the other thing I wanted to point out is that on the left slide, you'll see these purple bars. These are the warning letters that are based on sample results, and these are pretty much the hand sanitizer warning letters that are starting to come out more in earnest as we wrestle with hand sanitizer contamination. Next slide, please. So let's talk about hand sanitizers. I'm probably going to go through these relatively quickly. A lot of the slides are the same ones that Dr. Michelle gave earlier, but I just wanted to kind of give some high-level points here. Next slide. So I want to use this soapbox just to point out one thing, is that, you know, that we do get questions about hand sanitizers versus washing your hands. And from the CDC, you know, hand sanitizers are there if you cannot wash your hands. The actual mechanical action of washing your hands and rinsing them off removes things from the surface of your skin, where hand sanitizers tend to kill certain things on your skin, but stuff still remains. So if you ever have the option of washing your hands or using a hand sanitizer, you should wash your hands. It is much more effective. And if you do use a hand sanitizer, when you get a chance to go to a sink to wash your hands, you should then go wash your hands. And the CDC recommendation includes that for alcohol-based hand sanitizers, they need to be at least 60% alcohol, alcohol in this case being ethanol. Next slide, please. This was from Dr. Michelle's talk. It really talks about how with COVID, the demand increased dramatically. Hand sanitizer went to a relatively small market to you cannot leave the house now without seeing hand sanitizer almost everywhere you go. Next slide, please. As mentioned, FDA has put out guidances to balance the need of increased hospital and consumer demand for hand sanitizer and the capability of the manufacturing base to manufacture hand sanitizer. The guidance has been put out and they've been updated as needed. Next slide, please. Just for easy inclusion, these are the links to the guidances so that you have them ready to go if you want to get the access to them. Next slide, please. And again, and I want to reiterate what Dr. Michelle said, the guidances talk about two formulas, one for ethanol-based hand sanitizers and one for isopropyl. And these formulas are vetted formulas, and that's one of the reasons why they are in the guidances. I also want to point out, you know, the CDC talked about a minimum of 60%, where these are up at 80%. Part of the reason that the 80% formula is the one in the guidance is that it does allow for some variability in the raw materials, and you'll still be well above 60%. So that's one of the reasons why we have the 80% formula in the guidances. Next slide, please. One of the things we've seen is that the hospital systems have now been able to source an adequate supply of hand sanitizers, where it is really crucial to have hand sanitizers. And we appreciate the work of industry. I think the number of firms that have joined is measured in the thousands. And so it has been really impressive to see kind of this industry kind of take the bull by the horns and start manufacturing. And with that, we'll transition into some of the requirements for alcohol. Next slide, please. So let's get right on into it. Next slide. So of the three guidances, one of the guidances talks about manufacturing alcohol for inclusion into alcohol-based hand sanitizers. And as Dr. Michelle mentioned, the manufacturing capacity to make pharmaceutical-grade alcohol is nowhere near large enough to manufacture what is needed to supply the demand that exists right now for alcohol-based hand sanitizers during the COVID-19 pandemic. So FDA put out a guidance related to the manufacturing of this active pharmaceutical ingredient, and it's got some stipulations in it. And I'm kind of going to walk through each of them and why they're there. So the first one is that, you know, the concentration of the alcohol that's manufactured has to be sufficient to make a hand sanitizer that meets the 80% concentration talked about before. If you're manufacturing an alcohol that is only 60% alcohol, there is no way for a hand sanitizer manufacturer to meet the, either the CDC requirements or the guidance requirements. And this is why the alcohol should be made so that the finished formulation can be about 80%. The water that's used to adjust any finished ethanol content has to be sterile. As Dr. Michelle mentioned, there are organisms, specifically bacillus, that lives in certain alcohols. We've actually had recalls of hand sanitizer this year because of microbial contamination, and it's a really concern if there's any broken skin that could get into the body. And so that's why the water that is used to adjust it has to be rendered sterile. Typically, boiling the water and then it's cool, so that's all you need to do, just like you would in anywhere else. The alcohol has to meet the interim impurity levels, and I'm going to talk more about the impurity levels in a little bit. Denaturants. As Dr. Michelle mentioned, we have a serious concern about children, particularly young children and others, drinking hand sanitizer by accident and the fatalities that can result. Denaturants are really there to ensure that, you know, the child does not drink more, only drinks a little bit, and, you know, maybe has a trip to the hospital versus a trip to the morgue. I mean, that's how serious we're talking about here. We recognize that denaturants, particularly in certain alcohol manufacturing facilities, are not the most wanted thing because they make things taste bad. And so because of this, we do not have a preference as long as the hand sanitizer itself is denatured. So the alcohol can be denatured, or you can have undenatured alcohol as long as the hand sanitizer manufacturer provides the denaturant. And there are three that are specified in the guidance. I want to point out one thing. There are other denaturants that are unacceptable for hand sanitizers, including methanol. All right. So if you're dealing with denaturants and alcohol, only the ones in the guidances are allowed for hand sanitizer manufacturing, and any other denaturant formula should be avoided. The alcohol has to be prepared under sanitary conditions, and the equipment is well maintained. This is, again, is to prevent microbial ingress or other contamination with filth. The most accurate method of analysis at the site is used to verify ethanol content. If we were in the classic pharmaceutical space where you are trying to hone in on a specific target for alcohol content, you would likely be doing some sort of chromatography. The science behind alcohol manufacturing is old, right? You know, the Egyptians were doing it. And, you know, the specific gravity, if you're manufacturing something that's primarily ethanol and water, the specific gravity test is quite accurate, particularly, you know, if you have finished hand sanitizers targeting 80% where there is some room for variability. So specific gravity is fine to use in this context, also known as an alcohol meter, just because of the colloquial term in the industry. And then the next term is that if the alcohol is distributed, it has to be labeled consistent with the labeling in the guidance, and we have example labels in the back of the guidance. And lastly, and the alcohol manufacturer, if they're selling into the hand sanitizer market, has to register with FDA. And the reason for that is that so we can understand who is in the market, and then if we need to send inquiries about what's going on, we are aware of who is making things, et cetera. Next slide, please. Now, there are different types of alcohol manufacturers out there. And when we formulated the guidance, we recognized that, right? There, you know, there was pharmaceutical grade alcohol that was being manufactured, but there was also alcohol being made for other markets. And the different types of facilities or processes that are involved would have different requirements for manufacturing alcohol for hand sanitizers. Again, our requirements for the alcohol is all patient-centric to make sure that the hand sanitizer is both effective and safe, and we have to look at the processes there. So the first one is the consumable alcohol manufacturers, primarily distillers, though we have seen some breweries get involved in this business too. But the alcohol is produced using, you know, the well-understood fermentation and distillation processes typically used for consumable goods, and the alcohol must meet the impurity limits that are specified in the guidance. Now, we also have something where we see alcohol made from synthetic processes. And it's very hard to specify exactly everything that needs to go in here because there are different alcohol sources from different synthetic processes. Some are petrol spinoffs, some are other chemical streams. And the alcohol can be considered if it meets the requirements of the USP in terms of its purity and content, or the Food Chemical Codex. And these are compendial that list out various tests and specifications for the alcohol. But I will say that, you know, the Food Chemical Codex has some information, but because we're talking about impurities and we're talking about dermal exposure versus oral, the impurities have to meet the USP, or it has to conform to the interim limits in the guidance, which were really built about the safety when exposing this alcohol to human skin on a constant basis. Next slide, please. And the third type of facility that we encountered was the fuel or technical grade alcohol facilities. And under the terms of the guidance, you know, if the alcohol is produced using fermentation and distillation, that's the type of process that we're comfortable with. But we have some few other stipulations that are specific to the fuel industry. One, no other additives or chemicals have been included. We did see a lot of specification sheets where we would see other things that were really added to it for the ultimate ethanol going into fuel. I mean, those things we don't have great toxicity data on. The alcohol has to meet the USP or FCC grades, or it has to meet the interim impurity limits in the guidance. And there's very specific instructions in the guidance related to the fuel alcohols. And the last one is pretty much what I consider to be the most important. The alcohol has to be screened for any potential harmful impurities not specified. The impurities that we talk about in the guidance are very specific to what we normally see. However, when the pandemic first started and we started interacting with the industry, we received a lot of information from a lot of different manufacturers, and we were seeing specification sheets that had, you know, ranges of chemicals that we were unfamiliar with or would not expect to see in pharmaceuticals, such as gasoline. We also saw specifications for, you know, benzene that were above the limits. And we realized, you know, the fuel ethanol industry sometimes does have other chemicals that are present for whichever reason. And so if you are a fuel manufacturer, actually if you're any manufacturer and you're manufacturing for alcohol for hand sanitizer, you need to know what other chemicals are in your environment and making sure that, you know what they are and that they're not in the alcohol if there is a concern. Next slide, please. So let's talk about the specific impurities and how it factors into alcohol manufacturing. Next slide. So what I have listed here are the various impurities that are detailed out in the guidance, and then I have two separate columns. The first column is what the standard limit we see is for pharmaceutical-grade alcohol that is the standard across the board. And these come from the United States Pharmacopeia. So the USP specification for methanol, our first one, is no more than 200 parts per million. Now, that is the standard that we would apply, and we would call any alcohol with more than 200 parts per million adulterated under the normal course of business. Now, under the hand sanitizer guidance, one of the things is that we coordinated with Dr. Michelle's group and the toxicologist to say, you know, the COVID pandemic is not forever. It's going to be for a certain amount of time. Is there an allowable level that's higher that can be tolerated for a short amount of time, and then when the pandemic ends, we revert back to the 200 parts per million? And this is all based on interim, you know, short-term exposure to toxic chemicals versus long, lifelong exposure. And so I do want to point out that you're seeing these higher limits, but they will revert back when the pandemic ends. And these, are only for the alcohol-based hand sanitizers, not for alcohol for other markets. And so, again, methanol has gone from 200 to 630 parts per million. Benzene, which is a carcinogen, aka causes cancer, that limit did not change. It's still 2 parts per million because the exposure is can be that troublesome. Acetaldehyde, and this one is a little confusing, I understand that, is that the standard limit's no more than 10 parts per million, and this is expressed as the sum of acetaldehyde and acetyl, and this is part of the test method. Acetaldehyde now has a specification of no more than 50 parts per million. And then acetyl on its own also has a specification of no more than 50. There's the sum of all other impurities, and that's where this 300 parts per million comes into play. But that does not include if you have a specific impurity that is, you know, of concern, which is what I talked about in some previous slides. So these are the primary impurities that, you know, are seen in alcohol manufacturing. And so let's talk a little bit about their properties. Next slide, please. So when we're talking about fermentation and distillation, right, that is the primary mode of manufacturing other than some of the synthetic alcohols that are out there. What it really comes down to is looking at the impurities and how they're separated out is looking at their vapor pressures, or also another way of looking at it is their boiling points. So methanol boils at 65 degrees Celsius, benzene about 80, acetaldehyde is much lower, it boils at about 20 degrees, right? But then at the bottom, you have ethanol, which is the active ingredient. And this boils around 78 degrees. And so you'll see that these different chemical constituents have different vapor pressures and different boiling points. And what this means is that when you are manufacturing alcohol, you have to keep an eye on when and how you're manufacturing alcohol, because different time-based or stream-based factors when you're doing distillation may have different concentrations. Next slide, please. So if you are a classic consumable alcohol distillery, a lot of the alcohol is manufactured using batch-based distillation or pot-based distillation. There are some industrial ones that are doing continuous, but you know, for the most part, your smaller distillers are using batch-based distillation. And so in this case, you have your mash, the fermentation, and then you start doing your distillation. And what you'll see is based on those vapor pressures, at different points in time, you will see a different impurity profile. And the terms used in the industry, you know, are called your foreshot, which is your very first one. Then you have your heads, hearts, and tails, talking about the beginning, the middle, and the end of the run, where the heart is the real section of the run where you're going to have the highest and purest concentration of alcohol. The higher vapor pressure or the lower boiling point impurities are going to come out first, and that's going to be concentrated in the foreshot or sometimes in the head, right? So that's where you will see the methanol content highest when you are doing pot-based distillation. And the flip side happens with the acetyl, right? The lower vapor pressure, the higher boiling point is going to come in the tail. And one thing I want to point out is when, you know, you're manufacturing for hand sanitizer, I know that sometimes folks will recycle different fractions. If you recycle, like, say, your foreshot or your end tails, all you are doing is just putting those impurities into the next batch, and sooner or later you are going to run into an excessive impurity run. And so recycling the fractions with the higher impurities is not really recommended. Next slide, please. Continuous distillation, the same scientific principles apply when we're talking about the vapor pressures and the boiling points, but with continuous distillation, it really comes about on more in terms of which fractions you're pulling out of the column. Your columns, some columns are simple. They just have a top and a bottom. Others can have a whole bunch of layers. Like if you're looking at, you know, petrochemical and cracking, you'll have like 10 or 12 different streams coming off your distillation columns. But the same fraction scenario applies when you're making alcohol. The higher vapor pressure impurities are going to find themselves in the top fraction, and the lower ones are going to find themselves in the bottom. And again, when sometimes with continuous distillation, there's a lot of recycling, you may need to consider whether or not recycling fractions is going to lead to higher impurities down the line. Next slide, please. So let's talk about the recent safety concerns that we've seen when it comes to hand sanitizers. Next slide. And this is from Dr. Michelle. Again, you know, we have seen issues in terms of ingestion, which is a nation concern, and we've seen issues related to methanol and 1-propanol. Next slide, please. And this is the case study that talked about the cluster of fatalities in the desert Southwest related to methanol hand methanol contaminated hand sanitizer. Next slide, please. And so what's the culprit in terms of what's going on? What are we seeing? And that is substitution. And this is the real reason I'm here today, is to talk about what we have seen and some of the requirements that are now going to be in place in terms of the industry and the supply chain for alcohol. And so I do want to thank you ahead of time, because I want to go through this, but I know that you're being asked to do some new things, and I want to walk you through why. Next slide, please. So again, I am a regulator, so everything we do is based on the law and what Congress passed. So this is Section 501D. I mentioned it earlier. It was passed in 1938. A drug is adulterated, again, that legal term, if its substance has been mixed or packed to reduce its quality or strength, or two, substituted wholly or in part, therefore. And I get asked this quite a bit, and so I put it in the slide. The therefore is not a typo. It does not have an E. It's actually old English language from used back in the 30s, and it means for that. Long story short, a drug, if it is adulterated, if it's supposed to be one thing, but intentionally or unintentionally, if something else has been put in its place. That is kind of the summary there. Next slide, please. So let's talk about the variants we've seen out there in terms of hand sanitizers. So on the left, you have isopropyl alcohol, known as IPA or sometimes 2-propanol. This is an acceptable ingredient for hand sanitizer. You'll notice these chemical structures. The black balls are the carbons, the white ones are the hydrogens, and the red are the oxygen. And the reason IPA is known as 2-propanol is that the oxygen is on the second carbon of the three. That is why it is 2-propanol. And on the right, you have 1-propanol, which, you know, chemically has the same molecules, but it's in a different structure. In this case, the oxygen is on the first carbon, which is why it's got the delineation 1-propanol. And this is not an acceptable ingredient for hand sanitizer. It's actually a toxic chemical. And we have seen 1-propanol being sold as other alcohols, and we've seen firms adding 1-propanol on purpose because they did not realize that it's, you know, not what it is. So we've seen some problems when it comes to 1-propanol substitution. Next slide, please. And here we have the one that's the larger issue to talk about today, and that is ethanol versus methanol. So on the left, you have ethanol. It's got the 2 carbons and the 1 oxygen coming off. That is an acceptable ingredient for hand sanitizer. It's an acceptable ingredient for a cocktail. That's ethanol. It's been around forever. And then on the right, you have methanol, all right? And that's the one that is the poison. You know, it's very similar. It's got 1 carbon instead of 2. I think one of the biggest concerns is that its specific gravity is almost identical. If you go into the engineering, books, the specific gravity test was not going to be able to delineate between ethanol and methanol. And that was one of the root causes of some of the substitution getting through, because specific gravity cannot tell the difference between ethanol and methanol. Next slide, please. So what did we see at the Mexican border? We have seen bottles of hand sanitizer. This one looks like a sports drinking bottle. That's got its own concerns. We've seen 55-gallon drums. Next slide, please. And then we've also seen, you know, gallon jugs just thrown in the back of a truck. So we've seen all kinds of hand sanitizer coming in all different venues and shapes and sizes across the border. Next slide, please. So as Dr. Michelle mentioned, methanol is extremely toxic, but it's got concerns exist both for ingestion and dermal exposure. Now, while the fatalities have been mainly for folks ingesting hand sanitizers and alcohol substitute, that doesn't mean that, you know, it's not serious if it's also applied to human skin. And this is from a recent warning letter we sent to a manufacturer where we had sampled their hand sanitizer and found it to be containing methanol. We mentioned that substantial methanol exposure can result in nausea, vomiting, headache, blurred vision, blindness, seizures, and death. And, you know, it's not often that FDA in warning letters is, you know, mentioning death. But because methanol is so risky, it's something that we really wanted to hammer home. Next slide, please. And this is a snippet from one of the warning letters. We've sent quite a few, unfortunately. You know, and I'm just going to read through some of it so you can kind of see what we're talking about here. The FDA lab testing of this batch of product found that the product contained 39% ethanol, so it's subpotent for ethanol, and that's because it has 28% methanol volume by volume. So in this case, we have a hand sanitizer that is 1/3 methanol. Doesn't take much to have toxic material, but when you're getting these concentrations, it gets really dangerous. And this material is labeled to be 70%. So if you look at it, you can see the substitution pattern, right? 39 plus 28 is just underneath 70%. So they're formulating to 70% alcohol, but they have 28% methanol in there. And then there's another sample that was tested. And in this case, the material actually contained no ethanol at all, 0%, and in fact was entirely formulated 83% methanol. And therefore, you know, we go into it and say that the these hand sanitizers are adulterated under 501(d)(2) of the Act. Next slide, please. Now, when, you know, we're dealing with GMP and enforcement, if we encounter methanol substitution, we're not considering just that particular sample to be adulterated. We consider the entire facility that manufactured to be out of compliance. And so we put in the warning letters that, you know, the substitution calls into question the quality assurance of the entire facility. Next slide, please. Now, we've been asked a lot, what is going on? Why is this happening? And we're still doing some research into this, but I can tell you some things. You know, the pattern that we see is very similar to other substitution cases that FDA has encountered historically. Here's some acronyms for you. Diethylene glycol, also known as antifreeze, or DEG, or ethylene glycol, EG, has been substituted into the glycerin market. Glycerin is used in cough cold syrups. It's a sweetener. It's used in toothpaste. And we've seen diethylene glycol, which is also sweet, but is also cheaper, substituted in. There have been deaths in other countries related to this substitution in the supply chain. About 12 years ago, we also saw oversulfated chondroitin sulfate, which was a man-made substitute, put in heparin. That led to approximately 100 patient deaths in the United States. And so we have seen these patterns of substitutions of these dangerous chemicals put in place of ingredients for drugs. And the pattern kind of emerges as like, you know, history repeating, right? You get a spike in product demand, a supply shortage, and therefore there's a price increase. And that causes an incentive for nefarious players to do things. The next piece of the puzzle you need is a murky supply chain where the supply chain is not well known. There's a lot of new players getting into the alcohol market, and that's one of the reasons that this happened in terms of the nefarious actors coming in. And the pattern that we've seen is that the substitution is likely happening at the API and broker level. And to give you an idea of the fact pattern we've seen, the manufacturers that we've tested and found out methanol, we talk to them, they say, well, we bought this ethanol. Here's a piece of paper. It came in a drum, and it says ethanol on the side of it. Here's a certificate of analysis with all kind of test results saying ethanol. But in fact, when it's tested, it's methanol. So we have players in the supply chain that are actively selling methanol to hand sanitizer manufacturers and to others and calling it ethanol, all right? So this is where the supply chain controls, we're talking about methanol testing, are going to come into play because, you know, we have seen multiple instances, way more than, you know, we've seen in the past on certain things where there's systematic selling of methanol for ethanol, particularly in particular regions. And again, the lacking controls that the finished dosage manufacturer let it slip through. In this case, the specific gravity test that people were using cannot differentiate between ethanol and methanol. So they would test this ethanol, it would have the right specific gravity, they would use it, and the next thing you know, there are adverse events. Next slide, please. So what is FDA doing when we run into this scenario? So the first thing, if we see methanol in a hand sanitizer or anywhere else, the first thing we're doing is we're talking to the manufacturer and talking to them about recall, market action to limit patient exposure of what's already out there. The second thing that we're doing is drugs and drug products made by those manufacturers are added to import alert 6678. This is the import alert saying, you know, the sample results demonstrate that your facility is out of control. Your drugs are not allowed to legally enter the United States. And then afterwards, we are issuing warning letters to detail the findings to the firm. And we've been doing continuing heightened surveillance of hand sanitizers. Well, most of the news talks about Mexico, and rightly so. You know, we have been sampling domestic hand sanitizer, and we've been sampling hand sanitizer from other countries as well. And we've been taking action as we see that we need to. And any of the hand sanitizers or drugs linked to these violative manufacturers are added to a do not use list for consumers. And I have the link here. So if any of you are involved in procuring hand sanitizers, I would definitely look at this list. If you're purchasing hand sanitizers, look at the list because it'll tell you whether or not FDA has encountered gross violations of the act from those manufacturers. Next slide, please. And very recently, in fact, yesterday, FDA placed all hand sanitizer made in Mexico on import alert. There's a link to the import alert here, which goes to the public website that talks about it. And again, this prevents hand sanitizers from legally entering the United States from Mexico unless firms have been able to demonstrate full compliance. And it was implemented due to the prevalence of methanol substitution from the region. The import alert goes into this. Of the samples that FDA took, 84%, okay, and that is a high number, 84% of samples were found violative. Either they were methanol contamination or they were subpotent, which has its own problems. And we use the countrywide import alert quite frequently in the food realm. You'll hear about things saying no lettuce from this particular valley due to a contamination event or other things like that. This is the first time that FDA has ever used a countrywide import alert for human drugs, and that's because the data is showing that there is a serious concern with methanol contamination from this area. Next slide, please. But while we've been talking about Mexico, I wanna also give some details on the scope of substitution. Only about 1% of the hand sanitizer manufacturers are currently associated with substitution, all right? So it's not, you know, something where, you know, you should think that every hand sanitizer out there is contaminated. And again, the majority of the methanol contamination hand sanitizers were manufactured in Mexico, and FDA is, you know, taking a pretty aggressive approach in dealing with that. But as mentioned earlier, you know, we get questions saying, well, is methanol just in Mexico? Shouldn't that take care of it? The answer, unfortunately, is no. We have put a firm on import alert that was manufacturing hand sanitizer from Turkey that was tested to contain methanol, and there's been a hand sanitizer that was manufactured in China that contained methanol. So, you know, at this point, you know, FDA has taken action against methanol and hand sanitizers from three separate continents, right? And not only that, we've talked to other regulators. There have been instances of methanol contamination, hand sanitizer in the Middle East. There's been in India. There's been in Russia. There's been in Europe. The methanol substitution, unfortunately, has gone global in terms of the alcohol demand and then these actors substituting in methanol for ethanol. And that is something that is really alarming. Next slide, please. And as Dr. Michelle was mentioning, you know, we started looking at this and saying, okay, we're seeing methanol substitution in more and more alcohol for hand sanitizers. Are there other risk factors? And we actually talked with USP. They looked into the formulations, and lo and behold, ethanol and isopropyl alcohol, you know, the two alcohols that we've seen that are susceptible to this, are used in quite a few pharmaceutical formulations. Inhalation products, you know, you don't want to inhale methanol. Mouthwashes, you know, use a high level of alcohol. Cough and cold products, including some manufactured for children, and a lot of topical drug products. All of these products have safety risks for patients if there is methanol contamination. And unfortunately, you know, while it was just limited to hand sanitizers, we've now seen that there's stuff that's starting to creep out. There's recent recall for methanol substitution that occurred for rubbing alcohol, and there's a link to the recall here. So, again, you know, we're very concerned that, you know, what has started off is a small, somewhat localized area is starting to balloon, and this is something why we're talking with you all today. Next slide, please. So let's segue into methanol testing requirements for drug manufacturers. We'll start with the hand sanitizer folks first. So next slide, please. So as this was evolving and we were taking these actions in the hand sanitizer space, we've updated our guidances periodically. On August 7th, the hand sanitizer manufacturing guidances were updated. And in order to continue to fall under the enforcement discretion described in the guidance, if you're a hand sanitizer manufacturer, if you buy alcohol from an outside source, you have to test it for methanol content. That is, you know, the stipulation now to manufacture hand sanitizers under the guidances. The testing has to be done prior to compounding or manufacturing, and this is applicable for over-the-counter hand sanitizer manufacturers and for, hand sanitizers made in either 503A or 503B compounding or outsourcing facilities. And again, it is regardless of what is on the C of A. At this point, from an FDA standpoint, I think a C of A that says something about alcohol and methanol is not worth much more than the paper is printed on based on the case files that we've seen out there. And it's a sad state of affairs that that's the case right now, but that's just, you know, what we're seeing. Next slide, please. There is one testing exception that exists for methanol testing. And this is based on the fact pattern of the cases we've seen, right? So as we deal with these manufacturers, we've seen that it's methanol being sold as ethanol in the open market. And we felt that when we were looking at this about, you know, how is this being made, you know, it's a substitution pattern. So the methanol testing for hand sanitizers really should be for hand sanitizers where the alcohol is bought on the market. So the only exception to it is that if a manufacturer is actually manufacturing their own ethanol, they will not need to test for methanol prior to manufacturing hand sanitizer. Again, this is only for alcohol made in-house by the actual firm that's making the hand sanitizer. So if a synthetic alcohol manufacturer is making alcohol and then the next room over they're turning into hand sanitizer, they do not need to test for methanol for substitution. But if they buy it from somebody else, even if it's, you know, the firm next door that they've known for years, they will need to test for methanol based on the patterns we've seen. Next slide, please. Also, one of the things that we did over the summer is that, you know, FDA has a great relationship with the United States Pharmacopeia. It's one of the few bodies where an independent pharmacopeia is recognized by name in FDA statute. And this goes way back to FDA's, you know, history, 100 years at this point. And so on July 30th, FDA sent a letter to the United States Pharmacopeia requesting an update to the identity section of the alcohol monograph. And I have the links to them here. And this is because, as I talked about these other substitution cases, diethylene glycol and glycerin, OSCS and heparin, part of the controls to ensure that patients didn't get hurt again was an update to the identity section. So we felt it was fitting to do it here. And the USP monograph was revised on September 1st, And now this compendial test for ethanol includes the specific test for methanol content. And I underline specific tests for a reason. Next slide, please. Under GMP, and this is where I get into the regulator hat mode, these are the Code of Federal Regulation citations. It talks about, you know, the requirements for pharmaceutical manufacturing. 211.84 is the requirements when it comes to receiving raw materials if you're going to make a drug product, whether it's a cough and cold drug or whether it's a mouthwash or whether it's a hand sanitizer. And in red, I've highlighted something that talks about each lot of components shall be withheld from use until it's been sampled and tested. And 211.84D talks about how you test, and it says, you know, you got to test to verify identity, right? And if a specific identity test exists, it shall be used. That is the regulation. It's pretty cut and dry. So with the identity test specifying methanol, if you're a drug product manufacturer, you know, it is expected that you will be testing for methanol as part of the identity test for pharmaceutical alcohols. Next slide, please. And this is, you know, commensurate with the patient risk in terms of why we are not only testing to verify ethanol, but the absence of unacceptable levels of methanol. And FDA provided further guidance on this just last week, January 19th. And I figured I would go into that for all of the folks on the phone. Next slide, please. So this is the name of the guidance, the policy for testing alcohol and IPA for methanol, including during the pandemic. You'll notice that that's not just for the pandemic, it's including the pandemic, but it's also a general policy as well. And there is a link to it on the bottom if you would like to read through the guidance. Next slide, please. And beyond going through the general background of why this policy was necessary based on the 20 plus fatalities of US citizens that have been seen, it gives some recommendations. And you'll notice that these recommendations are very similar to other recommendations seen where substitution has occurred in the heparin universe and in the glycerin universe. And the first recommendation is that drug product manufacturers know who actually made the alcohol. If you are a drug manufacturer and you get alcohol and it says, you know, Bob's Distribution House, but doesn't say where it's from, you have very little understanding of where it was made and how it was made. You have a piece of paper. And unfortunately, you know, that was one of the failure modes that caused the widespread substitution of methanol in Mexico. A lot of the firms we talked to, they didn't know who actually made the alcohol. They just said, hey, I bought this from a broker and it's got a C of A. It must be good. And here we are. The second recommendation is that personnel involved in drug manufacturing are made aware of the risks. So this is one of the reasons we're talking to you guys, but we're also asking that, you know, if you have folks in the quality area that are buying alcohol and using it, that they understand, hey, this has been seen, right, you know, so that when they're making decisions, they have in their brain, hey, you know, this pattern has existed where there's been substitution. So if they see something odd, they take a view and they understand, okay, I need to think about it this way as they make quality decisions. While the next thing is that the USP methanol test is suitable for both ethanol and IPA testing. The IPA monograph, it does not specify the methanol in the identity test at this point, but from a GMP standpoint and also from a technical standpoint, we had our chemists run the methanol test that's through its paces on isopropyl alcohol, and FDA considers the USP identity test for methanol to be satisfactory in terms of doing IPA identity testing and screening for methanol. Again, testing for drug product manufacturers, you have to test for methanol as part of identity prior to making a drug. And I've already seen a few questions pop up on the chat thing, and so I figured I would just nip this one in the bud. We are recommending that drug repackagers and distributors also conduct methanol testing. One of the things is that, you know, when you deal with supply chains, you will see material getting passed from one distributor, repackager to another, and that is the real weak spot in supply chains where a nefarious actor can insert themselves in between two legitimate manufacturers and get something in there. And so we are recommending that repackagers and distributors also conduct methanol testing. It's consistent with statutory CGMP. Next slide, please. And so now I'm going to wrap up, and I know you guys may have a lot of questions. I think we're going to have a question session later this afternoon. I'm more than willing to answer almost any question you can throw at me, so feel free to throw questions in, okay? And in summary, the Office of Manufacturing Quality, you know, our job is to minimize consumer exposure to unsafe, ineffective, potentially dangerous, or poor quality drugs, And, you know, we take actions when we find firms that have poor manufacturing practices or CGMP, or when we get other information that calls into question the quality of drugs for U.S. patients. And we've been a little bit busy in the hand sanitizer space. And I do want to say thank you. I know I'm talking to an industry, some of you are new to it, and so you're kind of, you know, trial by fire in terms of some of the things you're looking at. But also, I do want to thank you for kind of, you know, coming into the market and stepping up to manufacture. And that's why we want to talk with you. And I'm hoping to have a very lively Q&A session later to go into any questions you may have. And with that, I think I'll wrap up and I'll hand back to Robert to go to the next speaker or whatever's next.